Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us here on CBS News. I'm Elaine Quijano.
And I'm Lana Zack. Here's a quick look at some of the top stories we're following.
The South Carolina State House has passed a bill banning most abortions as early as 6 weeks into pregnancy. The full legislature passed a similar bill in 2021, but it was struck down by that state Supreme Court over privacy concerns.
Investigators are looking into the death of an 8-year-old migrant girl in federal custody in Texas. Officials say that the girl had a heart condition and was taken to a hospital where she was pronounced dead.
President Biden is in Hiroshima, Japan for the start of this year's G7 summit. However, he plans to cut his trip short and return to Washington this weekend to oversee debt ceiling negotiations.
All right, this is the talker story of the day. As young people are looking to make ends meet, maybe some people who aren't quite so young, more and more of us are turning to second and third jobs.
A survey from Bank of America says that 72% of Gen Zers have a, quote, side hustle. The majority of them earn between $500 and $1,000 per month. A recent Insider article calls Gen Z the hustle generation.
Well, joining us now is Eve Upton Clark. She wrote the piece and is a contributor for Insider. We have been talking about this piece, Eve, so much. Logistically, just tell us what this looks like. Are people adding freelance work to full-time jobs, taking two full-time jobs? Are they forgoing full-time jobs altogether? Elaine and I were also talking about landlording and all the different things that you might be doing. What did you find?
Well, I think there's a number of things going on. So in the data that I looked at, you know, half of Gen Z were employed at two or more places. Then 67% were going freelance, 62% had their own business. So there's actually a number of things that I think add up to this bigger picture. It's not just, you know, one model that people are going with. But yeah, I think the freedom and flexibility that has come kind of post-pandemic, where remote working has become more the norm, has sort of shown people that these old models of working aren't necessarily what they have to stick to, and that there are different ways that people can, yeah, that can approach their careers.
Yeah, Eve, I'm curious where this leaves companies. I mean, you write that some employers are embracing this trend, but also that some workers worry that they'd get fired if their bosses found out. So how do companies feel about their employees working multiple jobs?
Yeah, so it's interesting. One of the main sources that I spoke to in the piece, her employer is, I think she works full-time at an advertising agency, and her employer is well aware of her side hustles and is very supportive of that. I think, you know, the traditional way of looking at it is that, you know, it would be a distraction. Obviously, a lot of employers wouldn't like the idea that their employees are investing their time and energy into these other projects. But actually, if you sort of flip the script and think of, you know, the skills and experience that people are gaining, particularly at the beginning of their careers, that they can then invest back into their full-time job and maybe branch out and add some more strings to their bow.
Can I just follow up really quickly? Because Eve, this was something interesting that you go into a bit of detail about in your piece, is that because these side hustles oftentimes basically make people feel better, because they're able to sort of channel creative energy and whatnot into these other things, they actually bring that feeling to their regular day jobs, benefiting employers. Did I get that right?
Yeah, exactly. So it's being able to invest in time into your passions. And, you know, maybe someone is interested in photography or interested in writing, and then they could, you know, maybe do the social media for at their company, or, you know, write the newsletter. So there are ways that employers can look at this as a positive, not necessarily as a negative.
Eve, I'm just completely fascinated by this and have so many questions on it. But the number one question I really have is why? Why are people doing this? Is it because Gen Zers are trying to meet these long-term financial goals, like buying a house, working towards retirement? Or are people doing this because they feel like in just having one job, they're not going to be able to make ends meet?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, there's going to be multiple answers. There are going to be multiple reasons dependent on the case. But I think that obviously financial reasons is going to be part of that picture. You know, if you're having multiple jobs, you're going to have multiple streams of income. But also this idea of like the broken social contract, where, you know, the idea that you can work up in your career, buy a house, then maybe buy a fancy car and then retire comfortably is kind of shown to not be the case in all circumstances. And so instead of leaning into that, people are looking at, you know, doing things their own way and maybe taking a bit of the power back from employers and insecure job markets and all that.
All right. Well, Eve, you know, as you were talking about the broken social contract, both Elaine and I were like, it was resonating with us just with that idea. Will people be able to sustain this level of work, not just when they're young, but older?
I mean, obviously, Gen Z are just coming into their careers, and the oldest, I think, is 25. So it's difficult to say whether this is just people at the beginning of their careers kind of having different priorities and different responsibilities. But obviously, it would be silly not to kind of look at this and how this will have a ripple effect. And perhaps people, yeah, rather than trying to focus on one particular job, will be expanding their skill sets and really leaning into that and having, yeah, whether that's in one job or across multiple.
Yeah, a different way to think about work. Yet another different way to think about work. Eve Upton-Clark, Eve, thank you.
Thank you.
We're going to take a short break.
Stay with us. You're streaming CBS News Always On.
Well, get-rich-quick schemes are finding ways to incorporate artificial intelligence.
So earlier, CBS News spoke with a professor about what's happening as well as the limitations of AI in business. So, I mean, we're kind of like selling this like scams, but I kind of interpreted it more as overselling the capabilities of artificial intelligence. So we tried one of the popular ChatGPT business ideas, which is basically like writing children's stories, right? You give them a simple prompt and they write a story. And so the prompt that our producers gave was about two unicorns named Matt and Anne-Marie. They work for CBS News. One has crystal blue eyes.
Don't know who.
And one's Canadian. We'll put it that way. And then it's sort of a whole story. So I will say, the whole time I was reading it, I was like, this is adorable. Yeah. And then I don't know if Matt, what you thought. I thought there's actually no story arc here. It's like actually not a great story.
Kind of. It's like paragraph, paragraph, and it's like us rolling in the hills and in the enchanted castle. And it's like, where art thou, thy Anne-Marie Green?
Right. So yeah. If you're thinking that you're going to be able to crank out a bunch of children's books and you know, self-publish, what are some of the factors that you need to consider before you launch into a business like this?
Well, I mean, as I think you saw, AI is pretty good, but it's not a miracle, right? So the idea that you could kind of produce an amazing piece of work with very little effort isn't actually true, right? So you actually have to spend some time crafting the story yourself. AI can help you write, but it doesn't write in the top 10% of all writers out there. So you'll see a lot of low quality children's books out there, but it's still missing that human touch, at least for now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, they talked about this on the Senate floor this week. The ChatGPT guy was there saying, look, this might take jobs, and now here we are with people selling books. So as more of these people do these get-rich-quick AI schemes, the more that they pop up and people just sign up and say, I think I'll do that next. You know, what should people know before investing their time or money into these things?
And we should be clear, we're talking about maybe like you might see something on Instagram where a guy's like, I can tell you how to make money really easy using AI. Just sign up for my course.
Right.
So there you go.
So I think AI is really important, right? Everything we're seeing about early evidence is that it increases your productivity by 30 to 80% on lots of writing and analysis tasks. But it's really not magical secrets, right? What you have to do is use it yourself. So I actually recommend, and I make it my classes, everybody's required to use AI for everything. Yeah. So they get to use the systems and learn what they're good at and what they're bad at.
Wow.
And I think, the other thing that people need to know is that AI is only as kind of intelligent or as creative as the prompts that you give it. And so as an example, this story of you and I as unicorns, they said that one unicorn was from Canada, but it sort of describes me as a graceful unicorn with a radiant silver mane and shimmering blue eyes. Actually, you're the one with blue eyes.
Yes.
It also describes you as a Canadian, unicorn.
And you're actually
right.
Canadian.
So it's just like a little, like you just can't put random things in there and expect Shakespeare, though if you ask it to write it in a Shakespearean style, it will crank out something.
That's true.
So then that brings me to this. Then what is AI useful for and what are the limitations?
So It's good for a lot of things, right? It's almost best to think that like a person, like an intern that you have working for you. So tasks you to assign to an infinite intern who lies a little bit sometimes, wants to make you really happy, are things that are good to work with AI. So I will have it, you know, if I get stuck on a paragraph of writing, I'll ask the AI to give me 20 versions of that paragraph and use that as inspiration to continue, right? I'll use it as sort of a first pass for, you know, help me write this email that I'm having issues with, right? And so it can help you overcome blockages in your regular life and help you kind of be a better and more productive writer. It can work on lots of different tasks. You have to kind of try it to figure out what its limitations and successes are. So it's actually very, very useful across wide varieties of tasks, but not on its own. You need to help it out.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that you say that you have your students use it, because obviously the first thought that goes to my mind is, aren't you nervous that they might, you know, plagiarize something or just have them write the paper simply by putting in a prompt? So are you worried that this ChatGPT may turn into a crutch for students, and either that they might just have something write something completely that's mm-hmm. not theirs, or even hinder their critical thinking skills?
So everyone's cheating everywhere right now. I mean, that's cats out of the bag. I'm not even joking, right? It's universal right now that everyone is using chat. They were cheating before, now they're cheating using chat. So, but we're living in a world where AI is everywhere. So we have to get used to how to use it well, right? And so I make them talk about what prompts they're using. You have to change up how you teach in the classroom, but everybody's cheating on essays everywhere right now. So we should embrace this. And as an entrepreneurship professor, there's a lot of opportunities to get rich, maybe a little slower using this by using it as a tool, a co-founder, a multiplier of your own effort. And I want to teach students how to do that.
Yeah, Ethan, I'm with you. I think that it is going to transform things. But one of the things it's going to transform is probably teaching, probably your job, because now the expectation is not for a student necessarily to sort of conjure up something from scratch, but you better make it a hell of a lot better than, you know, what an AI bot's going to be spitting out.
Yeah.
So the level of expectation is going to be higher.
Has to make sense.
Yeah.
Right? Has to make sense. All right. Well, hopefully we keep our jobs here as well. So Ethan Malik, thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, if you're a snacker, it seems you are in good company. A new report found people in the U.S. are snacking more than ever. And here's more food for thought. Market research firm Circana Group finds that most people are actually eating three or more snacks a day.
Well, Wall Street Journal reporter Jesse Newman joined CBS News to discuss American snacking habits.
Why are we seeing this surge in snacking?
Well, we have truly become a nation of snackers. As you, I'm sure everyone knows, you know, we have been snacking in this country for a long time. But what we have seen is that in the past decade, this has really been a rising trend. Per capita consumption is up, and snacking got a boost during the pandemic that really hasn't receded. So, food experts really put this on the shoulders of younger consumers, millennials and Gen Z. They are leading the way towards snacking and really sort of grazing throughout the day. Gone are the days of three meals a day, and now we all just sort of like munch our way through.
Yep. Remember when we all put on those pandemic pounds?
Right.
That was probably part of it. So what companies are seeing their sales soar as a result of this shift?
So you've got the pure play snacking companies that are really seeing a sales increase that far outstrips most other packaged food companies. So you can think of Hershey and Mondelez and Hostess. Their sales from 2019 to 2022 were up, you know, between 22 and 50%. So those are huge gains.
So you mentioned the pandemic, and also in your article, you mentioned that some people are replacing meals with snacks. I'm thinking back to the pandemic when like restaurants were closed.
It's
and
true.
You were lucky if you got to a supermarket. So before you knew it, you really were like, wait, what's in here? What's the expiration date on this?
I know. But this actually made a lot of sense to me, because I thought to myself, I can't think of a time where I sat down to eat lunch. Really, it's usually just kind of grabbing something.
Grab
you know?
And go. So mm-hmm. what are people replacing meals with snacks? Tell us more about that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right. So more and more, you know, the younger generations are turning to snacks for meal replacements. So they're looking for convenience and just to grab something. And it's pretty interesting because, you know, snacks, if you are from an older generation, snacks were sort of thought of as an indulgent treat, right? Mm-hmm. Like I can remember my mother having peanut M&Ms in late afternoon. But now they really are, you know, consumers are looking to replace snacks. So they're looking to, you know, protein bars and things that can be that can either replace or complement a meal. And so they're looking to snacks for different types of attributes. They want protein, folks want fiber. You know, they want all sorts of functional benefits in a snack.
I need to up my game, because honestly, I have the Costco size peanut M&Ms on my counter as we speak. So your mom and I are hand in hand,
really? And
literally.
It's just fistfuls?
Fistfuls. But I guess I need a protein bar, obviously.
Well, I have been guilty of having cheese for dinner, just a plate of cheese. You know why? Because cheese is delicious, and I'm an adult, and I should be able to eat whatever I want.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
that's,
of course.
That's what I told myself. So we are seeing people sort of leaning into healthier snacks, and I thought your article was really fascinating in the way that these companies are trying to be creative in what kind of falls into the snack category to get more people interested.
That's right. You see the traditional packaged food companies that have obviously taken notice, you know, for years now of the trend towards snacking, and they are all leaning into snacks. So they are trying to build out their own portfolios, whether it's acquiring new brands or just offering their older traditional brands in a more snackable form. So you see, you know, words these days, everything is snackable and poppable and bite-sized. And that is all to feed our snacking habit.
You know what I thought also was interesting, Jesse, in your article? That people are brand loyal. That you would think, like, what's it, you know, get a cheese puff anywhere, get it from like the dollar store. Yeah. But no, they want their specific brand of those snacks.
Snacks are pretty insulated from cheaper store brands, private label, more so than other categories. And so, you know, companies can, you know, consumers will stick with their snacks, particularly chocolate and other things, you know, even when prices increase. Because look, when you want to feel good and grab that chocolate bar, you want the brand you know is going to taste good.
That's my husband. He likes pretzels and chips. He has to eat them simultaneously in the same bite, and it has to be the specific brand. I'm like, it's a regular chip and a regular pretzel. It doesn't matter.
Some of them stick out to you, though, too, because you think of, like, a Kind bar. It's like, oh, that sounds so healthy, and it sounds so kind.
Don't read the
but
label.
But really, I'm like, wait, is that really? But you're right. I mean, brand loyalty is a thing, right? I mean, people just grab for what they know. Yeah.
Yeah. That's right. So I hope it's healthy.
Yeah, let's hope that it is. All right. Well, Jesse Newman, thank you so much for this. And now we're going to go get some snacks.
Yeah, now you made us hungry. Thanks.
Thanks.
Coming up, it's America Decides. Sources tell CBS News that Florida Governor Ron DeSantis is planning to announce a run for president next week, what his formal entrance into the race could mean for the 2024 GOP field.
And President Biden is in Japan for the G7 amidst debt ceiling talks back home. We take a look at the state of the negotiations right now. America Decides is next. You're streaming CBS News.